Your call to set up a time for us to have a chat before we go into doing baptism. So make sure that you fill that out so that I can read it and then I can give you a call. All right? That'd be great. I don't know, make sure you guys pick up one of these. Okay? Refrigerator magnet or wherever you want to put it. I don't care. Whatever. You can put that somewhere. That would be great. All right, so I was thinking how many Easter messages I've given over the last 40 years to either kids or students, and it's been 40. Okay, and you know, it took you guys a while, but you got it. Good job. But as a pastor, every time a holiday comes up, you're like, here it is again. What's a different way that I can do this? The same message in a different way. How can I be more creative, right? How can I be more original, right? And so this year, so I was praying about all this, God said, you know what? You need to talk about the core of Easter. I know that sounds crazy, but in fact, the reason why this church exists, the reason why this church is here, is because of this thing called the resurrection. The reason why, if you have placed your faith in Jesus, that you have a future and a hope, is because of the resurrection. The reason why we celebrate Easter is because of the resurrection. The reason why you can have a guaranteed place in heaven is because of the resurrection. The reason why the power of sin has been broken in your life is because of the resurrection. Like, the entire foundation of our faith rises and falls because of the resurrection. It's key. It's central. And in our culture today, there are those, not only do they not believe that Jesus rose from the dead, they don't even think that there is a resurrection for those who have died. You just are born, you live, you die, and you're gone. That's it. And here's what you need to understand. It was no different in Jesus' day. Like, these thoughts have not just started like in the last 50 years. No. There were people that were like that and thought that way in Jesus' day. In fact, the Apostle Paul, when he was writing his letters to the churches, he wrote this one letter to this church that was brand new, and he knew that everything hung on the fact that Jesus rose from the dead. And in his letter to the church in Corinth, chapter 15, that's where we're going to go today, of 1 Corinthians chapter 15, he reminded the believers the fact that you can't separate the resurrection from the gospel. You can't. They're connected. There is this overwhelming evidence Paul wants us to know about that Jesus rose from the dead. It's in other historical documents. It's not just in the Bible. After the crucifixion, his crucifixion, they put Jesus into a tomb and covered it with a two-ton stone and sealed it. Okay, so I want you to watch this clip, okay? From this movie that came out a while ago. Watch this. Here we go. Turn up the sound, guys. Thank you.
You smell
there's
it.
There's your solution.
A feast?
Burning in public. God forbids.
There's your solution.
Burning in public.
God forbids cremation.
He also forbids labor on the Sabbath, and yet
here you are. The crucified man's agony.
Tribune.
Why? His business unfinished. The man's dead, Caiaphas. His followers are in hiding. He's no longer a threat to your monopoly.
The man's dead, Caiaphas. His followers are in hiding. He's no longer a threat to your monopoly on piety.
But still a threat, Prefect. While alive, that deceiver said he would rise again after 3 days. He foretold it. We request that the sepulchre be sealed, lest his disciples come in the night, steal the body, and say that he is risen from death. That would cause more unrest in this city than all his blasphemies combined.
You have your own guard. Secure it yourself.
My words exactly.
To which I replied, we need a Roman seal. This must be seen as the impartial will of the prefect.
And not yours.
We seek only what Caesar seeks. Peace in Jerusalem, peace in Judea, which you will lose if this body vanishes.
Hence my summoning.
Just see to it. Satisfy yourself.
Seal it.
Seal.
So not only did they seal it, but there were 7 of the 14 guards guarding a dead guy. And on the third day, the guards scattered. The seal was broken. The rock was moved. And he was seen by Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James. Then he was seen by Peter. Then he was seen by all the 12. Then he was seen by more than 500 at one time. Seen by James and again by the 12. And then seen by Paul. And as I could just see, as Paul is writing this with some horsepower, I could just see that he's pressing harder on the parchment as he's writing this. And he reminds them, he says, listen, this is the message that you continue to believe. This is what defines you as a church, is this message. And they believe that there was this connection between the resurrection and the gospel. But then Paul was hearing that even though that's what was defining them, some of them, they didn't believe in the whole concept of resurrection. Like the whole concept was just out of their frame of reference. They were like, I don't know. But listen to this. You cannot separate the resurrection from the gospel. In fact, in this passage that we're going to read today and that we're going to go through, Paul gives us 7 realities about why resurrection is so crucial for our faith and our life with God. All right, we're going to start in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 12. This is what Paul writes. But tell me this. Since we preach that Christ rose from the dead, why are some of you saying there will be no resurrection of the dead? For if there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ has not been raised either. All right, so he's going, okay, let's take your logic. If you say there's no resurrection of the dead, well then Christ could not be raised. And so the first reality about this is this. Jesus' resurrection proves that resurrection will be a reality for me. His resurrection proves that there will be a reality for you and me. Right, so he's starting off with that. There's the first reality. Then in verse 14, he says this, and if Christ has not been raised, then all of our preaching is useless and your faith is useless. That word useless, kenos, means it's empty. It's hollow. It has no substance. All right? One of the theologians that, when I was getting ready for this, listen to what he says. He says this, the person and work of Christ are the bed, are the rock upon which the Christian religion is built. If he is not who he said he was, and if he did not do what he said he had come to do, the foundation is undermined and the whole superstructure will collapse. If he didn't come to do what he said he was going to do. And so the second reality is that Jesus' resurrection validates my resurrection. His resurrection validates your resurrection. The fact that he was resurrected, it validates that fact. Okay, validates. Okay, so I have a chart. I want to show you this chart. Let's put that next thing up there. William, can we do that? Okay, listen. Okay, so my resurrection is strengthened by my hope in Jesus' resurrection, which is motivated by God's promise in Jesus' resurrection, and then the promise is sealed by the reality of Jesus' resurrection. That's why this whole idea of resurrection is so important in this. Because if resurrection isn't even a reality for human beings, then Jesus would not have been resurrected. It is a part of who we are as human beings. And it's all connected together. It's all connected together. All right, verse 15. Listen to what he continues to write. And we apostles would all be lying about God, for we have said that God raised Christ from the dead. But that can't be true if there is no resurrection of the dead. And if there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ has not been raised either. So Paul's making a very good point here in this whole argument. And it's this, third reality. If people aren't resurrected after they die, then Jesus could not be resurrected. I want that to soak in for a second. If people are not resurrected after they die, then Jesus could not be resurrected. In fact, this concept of resurrection started in the Old Testament. It started in the Old Testament. It was something God created at the very beginning. Listen to what this says in Isaiah chapter 26, verse 19. It says this, but those who die in the Lord will live. Their bodies will rise again. Those who sleep in the earth will rise up and sing for joy. And then in Daniel chapter 12, verse 2, listen to what this says. Many of those whose bodies lie dead and buried will rise up, some to everlasting life and some to shame and everlasting disgrace. And I talk about this like during funerals. I talk about this. The fact is, you know what? Everybody's going to be resurrected. The issue is, where are you going to spend eternity? I want you to think about that for a second. Where are you going to spend eternity when you are resurrected? Because these are temporary. There will be a day when you will be resurrected. But the question is, where are you going to spend eternity? Are you going to spend eternity with Jesus in heaven? Or are you going to spend eternity in hell? There's no in between. Heaven or hell. The reality of resurrection. Verse 17, listen to what he writes. If Christ has not been raised, then your faith is useless and you are still guilty of your sins. Are you starting to see the significance of resurrection? Fourth reality, without the resurrection, we are doomed to hell because of our sins. Without resurrection, we are doomed to hell because of our sins. Jesus made it very clear that he came to break the power of sin in your life. Do you know what sin always brings? Death. Always. And so he came to break that power of sin in our lives. Okay, verse 18. In that case, all who have died believing in Christ are lost. I wonder how many of us here in this room have known people that have said, that you know they were Christ followers and they've passed away. And you had a celebration at their funeral. And yet, Paul is saying, okay, look, if Jesus hasn't rise from the dead, guess what? They're still lost. That's the significance of resurrection. That's the significance of Jesus not only dying on the cross, but rising from the dead on the third day. All right? And then verse 19, he keeps going. He says, and if our hope in Christ is only for this life, we are more to be pitied than anyone in the world. If it's only for this life. And there are different cultures, church cultures out there or whatever, that, you know what, they celebrate that they know Jesus. When they're at church, they talk like they know Jesus, and they can speak Christianese. They know how to talk. They know what to say. It's all about now, because they think that Jesus came to the cross to bless them and give them stuff and make them rich or make them prosperous or give them power or give them a platform or whatever. And Paul is saying, if that is the only reason why Jesus was resurrected, we're in trouble. Because there will be a day when that will all be over. It'll be done. And Paul is saying, no, 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 no. Jesus' resurrection has to do with not only this life, but the life to come. But the life to come. Reality number 6, Jesus' resurrection not only gives me hope for this life, but also the life to come. Not only hope for this life, but also the life to come. How does he give you hope for this life? Well, he said it numerous times. He said, I'm going to leave you a gift. I'm going to leave you peace. Not the peace that the world gives. I'm going to leave you the peace that I give. And do you know why that we can have peace? If you have put your faith in Christ, you know where your destiny is. You know where your eternity is going to be. You know, without a shadow of a doubt. And you can have peace of mind knowing that God's Spirit is involved. He says, I'm going to be your comforter and your counselor. I'm going to lead you in all truth. That's what he does. So we can have peace, right? And then in verse 20, he says, but in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead. He is the first of a great harvest of all who have died. Okay, let's stop there for a second. It says he is the first of a great harvest of how many who have died? All. All. Remember in Greek, all means all. Right? And so, because Jesus rose from the dead, guess what? Now we can all have that faith in the fact that when you're done here, guess what? You will be resurrected. And if you have put your faith in Christ as your Savior, as your Lord, He's the one that you're putting your hope in. Guess what? When that day arrives, you will be with Him in heaven. That's how crucial the resurrection is. Reality number 7, Jesus' resurrection proves that we will be resurrected on our last day. Easter is resurrection. That's why it's so crucial. That's why as a Christ follower, right? That defines who we are. We worship a risen Savior. We don't worship some other person who's still 6 feet underground. We worship a risen Savior. The resurrection of Jesus proved to the world that you can come to God with all of your brokenness, all of your hurt, all of your failures. He will forgive, embrace, and empower you to live a life that honors Him. That's the significance of the resurrection. Do you know when this was played out? The last words that Jesus spoke to somebody before he gave up his spirit and he died. Jesus was on the cross. There were two thieves on either side. One thief was just going at Jesus. The other thief that was on the other side of Jesus recognized his need for Jesus. Okay? But he was on the cross. He knew he was dying. Okay? He didn't have a chance to clean up his life. He didn't have a chance to get involved in some Bible study. He didn't have a chance to start going to church. He knew, my life is going to be over. And I know I have not had a very good life up to this point. And I know, you know what? I pretty much deserve to be here. And then he looks at Jesus. And he's hearing this other guy on the cross just blast Jesus. And the other thief goes, aren't you even aware of what's taking place here? We deserve to be here. I was with you when you did all your knuckleheaded stuff. We deserve to be here. He doesn't. He didn't do anything wrong. And then, you know, he looks at Jesus. And he said, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Okay, stop right there. Remember me when you come into your kingdom. Okay, something has shifted inside this guy's brain and his heart. And he goes, oh, this is my chance. Right here, this is it, my last chance for me not to only get right with God, but secure a future with God. This is my last chance. And then Jesus, who's this close to breathing his last breath, looks at him and he says, I assure you today, you will be with me in paradise. Do you know why he said that? Because resurrection is true. resurrection is true. And he knew this is the last time this guy is going to be in this body. The next moments, he's going to be transformed. And he will be resurrected. And he has just put his faith in the fact that Jesus is the one who's going to make it possible for him to be in heaven. That's resurrection. That's Easter. That's Easter. And so for us here this morning, as we are celebrating the fact that he is risen, as you leave this place, we're going to sing this last song together, but as you leave today, my prayer is God brings this up to you throughout the whole day, one way or another, in different circumstances, as you're with family, as you're eating, as you're, I don't care what you're doing, but when you think about Easter, the one word that comes to your mind is resurrection. Resurrection. All right, so let's stand. We're going to sing this last song together.